Good morning students, welcome to SST So Simple Tutorial. Today I am going to start revision of lesson 3 Nationalism in India of your history textbook. This session will be useful to those, remember, who have read the book and understood the lesson properly. If you have not read the book or watched my lessons, I would suggest you watch those videos first. The links of those videos are given in the description. Let us begin with Unit 1 now, the First World War, Khilafat Movement and Non-Cooperation Movement. How did First World War help in the growth of the nationalist movement of India? The First World War created hardships and misery for the common people. It led to huge increase in defense expenditure, which was financed by war loans and increasing taxes. Custom duties were raised and income tax introduced. Prices of commodities doubled between 1913 and 1918, leading to extreme hardship for the common people. Villages were called upon to supply soldiers, and the forced recruitment in rural areas caused widespread anger. Then, in 1918-19 and 1920-21, crops failed in many parts of the country, resulting in acute shortages of food. People expected that their misery would end once the war was over, but these hopes did not materialize. How did Mahatma Gandhi successfully organize Satyagraha movement in various places just after arriving in India? Explain by giving three examples. After arriving in India, Mahatma Gandhi successfully organized Satyagraha movements in various places. First, in 1916, he traveled to Champaran in Bihar to inspire the peasants to struggle against the oppressive plantation system. Second, in 1917, he organized a Satyagraha to support the peasants of the Kheda district of Gujarat. The peasants of Kheda were affected by crop failure and plague endemic, so that they could not pay the revenue and were demanding that revenue collection be relaxed. In 1918, he went to Ahmedabad to organize Satyagraha movement amongst cotton mill workers. Why did Gandhiji consider it important to support the Khilafat movement? As the Rowlatt Satyagraha was limited mostly to cities and towns, Gandhiji felt the need to launch a much more broad-based movement in India. But he was certain that no such movement could be organized without bringing the Hindus and Muslims together. Gandhiji saw in the Khilafat issue an opportunity to bring Muslims under the umbrella of a unified national movement. So, Gandhiji considered it important to support the Khilafat movement. Let us now go to the next subunit. Different strands within the movement. What were the economic effects of non-cooperation movement? This is an important question. The effects of non-cooperation movement on the economic fronts are as follows. 1. Foreign goods were boycotted, liquor shops picketed, foreign clothes were burnt into huge bonfires. 2. The import of foreign clothes halved between 1921 and 1922, and its value dropping from rupees 102 crores to rupees 57 crore. You must write these figures. In many places, merchants and traders refused to trade in foreign goods or finance foreign trade. As the boycott movement spread and people began discarding imported clothes and wearing only Indian ones, production of Indian textile mills and handloom went up. Now here, both the topics, rebellion in the countryside and Swaraj in plantations, are important. Let us see the questions. What led to spread of non-cooperation movement to the countryside. Explain any three factors. The peasants had to do begar at landlord's farm without any payment. The tenants had no security of tenure and were regularly evicted from land. The peasants demanded reduction of revenue and abolition of begar and boycott of oppressive landlords. Analyze the features of Gudam rebellion of Andhra Pradesh. In the Gudam hills of Andhra Pradesh, the colonial government had closed the entry of people to the forests to graze their cattle or to collect fruit and firewood. This enraged the hill people. When the government began forcing them to contribute begar for road building, the hill people revolted. The revolt spread in early 1920s under the leadership of Alluri Sitaram Raju. The rebels proclaimed that he was an incarnation of God, as he had a variety of special powers. He could make correct astrological predictions and heal people. Raju talked about the greatness of Mahatma Gandhi and was inspired by the non-cooperation movement, but at the same time asserted that India could be liberated only by the use of force and not non-violence. Next question. Plantation workers too had their own understanding of Mahatma Gandhi and the notion of Swaraj. Explain. For plantation workers in Assam, freedom meant the right to move freely in and out of the confined space in which they were closed, and it meant retaining a link with the village from where they had come. When they heard of the non-cooperation movement, thousands of workers defied the authorities, left the plantations and headed their homes. They believed that Gandhi Raj was coming and everyone would be given land in their own villages. They interpreted Swaraj as a time when all sufferings and troubles would be over. Let us go to the next subunit. Towards civil disobedience. Why was the non-cooperation movement withdrawn by Gandhiji? The movement was turning violent. At Chauri Chaura in Gorakhpur, a peace demonstration in a bazaar turned into a violent clash with the police, in which more than 20 policemen were killed. Gandhiji also felt that the satyagrahis need to be trained properly before they would be ready for mass struggle. Within the Congress also, certain leaders were tired of mass struggles and wanted to participate in elections to the provincial councils, which were set up under the Government of India Act 1919. Analyze the circumstances which led Gandhiji to choose abolition of salt tax as the most important demand of the civil disobedience movement. See, Mahatma Gandhi saw in salt a powerful symbol that could unite the nation. On 31st January 1930, he sent a letter to Viceroy Irwin stating 11 demands. The most stirring of all was the demand to abolish the salt tax. Salt was the most essential item of food and was consumed by the rich and the poor alike. Mahatma Gandhi declared that the tax on salt and the government monopoly over its production revealed the most oppressive face of British rule. The demands were not fulfilled, so Mahatma Gandhi on 11th March started his famous salt march with 78 volunteers from his ashram in Sabarmati. Write about the role played by women in civil disobedience movement. There was a large-scale participation of women in civil disobedience movement. During salt march, thousands of women came out of their homes to listen to Gandhiji. They participated in protest marches, manufactured salt, picketed foreign cloth and liquor shops. Many went to jail. In urban areas, these women were from high caste families. In rural areas, they came from rich peasant households. Moved by Gandhiji's call, they began to see service to the nation as the sacred duty of women. Mention efforts made by Gandhiji to get Harijans their rights. Gandhiji was of the opinion that Swaraj would not come for 100 years if untouchability was not eliminated. He organized Satyagraha to secure their entry into temples and access to public wells, tanks, roads and schools. He himself toured their colonies and even lived there. He himself cleaned toilets to dignify the work of the Bhangi and persuaded upper castes to change their heart and give up the sin of untouchability. He signed Pune Pact with Dr. Ambedkar, through which some seats were reserved for them in provincial and central legislative councils. Explain the role of Ambedkar in uplifting the depressed classes. This is again a very important question. In 1930, Ambedkar entered national politics. In the same year, he organized the Depressed Classes Association to make them politically stronger. He was of the opinion that only political empowerment would resolve the problems of social justice. Due to his efforts, they began organizing themselves, demanding reserved seats in educational institutions and separate electorate that would choose the Dalit member for legislative councils. He was nominated as a delegate of the oppressed classes for the second round table conference. In that conference, he clashed with Mahatma Gandhi by demanding separate electorate for Dalits. Next question. Muslim political organizations in India were lukewarm in their response to civil disobedience movement. Give reasons. Here you will write the points one by one. 1. Association of Congress with Hindu Mahasabha. After the decline of non-cooperation Khilafat movement, a large section of Muslims felt alienated from the Congress. From the mid-1920s, the Congress came to be more visibly associated with Hindu religious nationalist groups like the Hindu Mahasabha. 2. Communal clashes. As relations between Hindus and Muslims worsened, each community organized religious processions with militant fervor, provoking Hindu-Muslim communal clashes and riots in various cities. Every riot deepened the distance between the two communities. 3. Issue of demand for separate electorate. Some of the Muslim leaders demanded a separate electorate for Muslims, which was not supported by Congress leaders. Next, status of Muslims in Hindu majority state. Many Muslim leaders and intellectuals expressed their concerns about the status of Muslims as a minority within India. They feared that the culture and identities of minority would be submerged under the domination of Hindu majority. Then, the issue of reserved seats in the Central Assembly. Leaders like Jinnah demanded reservation of seats for the Muslims in the Central Assembly, but this was not acceptable to the Congress leaders. So, Muslims could not respond to the call for united struggle. How did the political leaders differ sharply over the question of separate electorate? 1. The Congress leaders knew it well that it was the mischief of the British government who encouraged different people to ask for separate electorates because such a policy would weaken the national movement and prolong Britishers' stay in India. Therefore, the Congress leaders opposed the policy. They were in favor of joint electorates. 2. Muslim leaders like Jinnah and Muhammad Iqbal demanded separate electorate to safeguard the interests of the Muslims. In their opinion, the majority of the people were Hindus, and so, in case of joint electorates, the Muslims would have little chance of winning the seats. 3. the leaders of the depressed classes, B.R. Ambedkar, also demanded separate electorate because in a joint electorate, he feared the dominance of upper caste Hindus in the elections. By the Pune Pact, he, however, agreed to have joint electorates with the Hindus. Let us see now the last question. Describe the cultural processes through which nationalism captured people's imagination. It was through a variety of cultural processes that people belonging to different communities, regions or languages developed a sense of collective belongings. Write the different points one by one. First, figure or image. Abanindranath painted his famous image of Bharat Mata. Devotion to this mother figure came to be seen as evidence of one's nationalism. 2. Song. In 1870, Bankim Chandra Chattopadhyay wrote Vande Mataram as a hymn to the motherland. It acquired the status of nationalist song. 3. Flag. In Bengal, a tricolor was designed. Gandhiji himself had designed the Swaraj flag. The Swaraj flag was a tricolor flag with a charkha at the center. Charkha represented the Gandhian ideal for self-help. The flag became a symbol of defiance. Next, folklore. Nationalists began recording folk tales sung by bards. They told villagers to gather folk songs and legends. These tales gave a true picture of the traditional culture. It was considered necessary to preserve the folk traditions in order to discover one's national identity and restore a sense of pride in one's past. Lastly, reinterpretation of history. Indian wrote about the glorious development in ancient times when art and architecture, science and mathematics, religion and culture flourished. India saw a decline with the coming of colonial power. Therefore, it was propagated that it was necessary to do away with the British rule in order to achieve the past glory. Let me stop here now. You read the lesson properly and thoroughly. We will meet with the revision of another lesson shortly. Till then, have a nice time. Thank you.
For more such videos, please don't forget to subscribe and press the bell icon. Thank you.